In this chapter, we're going to study oscillatory motion. First, let's take a look at some examples of oscillatory motion. What exactly is oscillatory motion? Well, for example, you can think of a grandfather clock, the arm of a grandfather clock ticking back and forth. That's called an oscillation, of course. And there are plenty of other examples. For example, if you attach a mass to a spring and you pull the mass and let go of it, then the spring will pull the mass back and it starts to go back and forth in an oscillatory manner. Oscillatory motions are very, very common, and we have so far not studied quite oscillatory motion in general, so we're going to do that in this chapter. One of the related concepts is called periodic motion. Not all oscillatory motions are periodic. If a motion is periodic, then by definition, it has to repeat itself exactly after a certain amount of time, which is called a period, or T. Some oscillations can go back and forth, but they don't go exactly back to the original position. In that sense, we don't say it's quite periodic. Now, let's take a look at the period of an oscillation, T. By definition, if it's a periodic motion, then after a time T, the motion repeats itself. The longer the time T, the slower the repetition. On the other hand, we can also have a related concept called the frequency, or F. That's called frequency. What is frequency? Well, by definition, frequency is the number of repetitions per unit time. For example, the number of oscillations per second. The greater the frequency, the faster the motion repeats itself. Unlike period, the longer the period, the slower the motion repeats itself. So obviously, there is a connection between the two. Let's look at a numerical example. Suppose the oscillation, a certain periodic oscillation, takes half a second to finish. So what is the period? Well, by definition, 0.5 second. That's the time it takes to repeat itself, or 1/2 a second. So T, in this case, equals 1/2 a second. On the other hand, what is the frequency? Well, the frequency is the number of oscillations per second. And since it takes half a second to complete each oscillation, there will be 2 oscillations per second. So by definition, F equals 2 per second. Now you look at these two numbers, T equals 1/2 a second and F equals 2 per second. Obviously, this is a reciprocal relationship. In general, T equals 1 over F. The unit for T in SI system, of course, is seconds, because that's just time. Frequency is, of course, 1 over second, but we have a special name for it. For that particular 1 per second, we call it Hertz, HZ for short. This is named after the physicist Hertz. And I'm sure you're familiar with this particular unit. 10 hertz means 10 cycles per second, or 10 oscillations per second. And if you buy a computer, you're talking about megahertz for the clock speed and so forth. 1 megahertz means 1 million cycles per second. All right. There are many, many different types of oscillatory motions, and we're going to focus on a particularly simple kind. So simple, we simply call it the simple harmonic motion. What does the term simple mean here? And what about harmonic? What does it mean? Well, it's a long story, and we're going to start with something we learned from the previous chapter, which is elasticity. Okay. We learned from the previous chapter that many, many materials possess this elastic property, and that is, it has the ability to restore itself. If you try to deform it, you have to fight over it. There is a resistance, and once the deformation force is gone, the material will try to restore its original composition. Okay, so the force that is initiated when you try to deform it, the force that the material try to fight back with, is called restoring force, because the function of that force is trying to restore the original configuration. Let's look at a particular example of a restoring force. Let's say the deformation is one-dimensional, call it x. That x, for example, could be the length, could be the elongation of a spring. Let's say the spring has a certain length, okay? And then when you pull it by a centimeter, so it's a centimeter longer than before, we say x is positive 1 centimeter. And if you compress it by 1 centimeter, we say x is negative 1 centimeter. So that's a special one-dimensional compression or elongation. F, that F is the force the spring, or in general, the system try to fight back. It is the restoring force. Take a look at the relationship between F and x. Okay, first of all, if x is zero, so is F. This is because you're not doing anything to the spring. You're not trying to stretch it or compress it, of course. The spring does not fight back at all. There's no force. So the curve of F versus x has to pass through the origin, zero, zero. That's for sure. Next, let's imagine you pull the spring. So it is longer than before, therefore x is positive. Okay, x is positive. What happens to the restoring force? In other words, the force exerted by the spring. Well, if you are trying to pull the spring, make it longer, the spring doesn't like that, so therefore try to get shorter. Therefore, the force of the spring is against that. It tries to make it shorter, so it goes toward the direction of decreasing x, or in other words, the compression direction. And that direction is called negative. If you call the elongation direction as positive, so therefore, when x is positive, f has got to be negative. So you have this curve which exists in the third quadrant. On the other hand, if you look at the case when a spring is getting compressed, so let's say, let me draw something better that way. Suppose this is the original spring, okay? It is fixed here, and this is the original length, we call natural length of the spring. We choose an x-axis going out like this, right? Here's the origin, which is located at the free end of the spring, where the spring is neither stretched nor compressed. In this case, what we're trying to do is we're trying to pull the spring longer, okay? So we pull the spring in this direction, so x is positive. The force of the spring, of course, is going backwards, and that is negative, so negative force. In this case, what we're doing here is we're compressing the spring. Okay, so the spring is not compressed like this. The origin is here. The movement of the spring, the compression of spring is this way, so x is now negative. As a result, the force of the spring is positive because the spring will push you back. So you have a positive force. And that is the second quadrant of this curve. In general, this curve can be complicated, except we know a couple of things. Once it has to pass through the origin, that's with no force, no displacement. The other thing is it must live in the second and the fourth quadrant because you know the direction of F, the restoring force, and x displacement has to be opposite to each other. But the curve can in general be complicated depending on what kind of material it is. It doesn't have to spring at all. It can be, for example, a rubber band. It can be even be a table. Of course, with a solid table, you don't push it a whole lot. The x is very small. Otherwise, it's going to break. But in general, there is a large class of materials with elasticity whose response curve in response to an external stretching or pushing behave like that. Now, since the curve is fairly complicated in general, let us look at some simplification. Is it possible for me to simplify this model? Well, even though the curve in general can be pretty complicated, I do know that it does pass through the origin, and what if I do not allow a very large amount of movement? In that is the case when x is very, very small. In other words, I can push the spring or pull the spring, but by tiny amount. So I'm focusing on this little portion of the curve. Now imagine I take this little portion of the curve and I blow it up to this curve. So basically, this curve is just a very, very small part of the first one. Let us amplify this part of the curve. You know, no matter how complicated the curve is, in general, if I look at only a small portion of the curve, it will look like a straight line. Okay, and that's the straight line. This is only an approximation, of course, but as long as I do not make x large, this is a valid approximation. Suppose I now focus on this particular region, which is called small oscillation, so because x is very small. Then I can pretty much safely say that f is linearly proportional to x, because this is very much a straight line. There is, of course, a constant of proportionality here, which, of course, is the slope of this curve. Now, is the slope positive or negative? If it's positive, then the curve will look like this, right? So the slope is negative. Therefore, we put a negative constant in front and we say f equals negative kx. That x, by definition, that k, by definition, is a positive number because I already have a negative number outside. What is the meaning of this k here? Well, k is the absolute value of the slope, mathematically. Imagine if k is very large. What that means is that for a small amount of displacement, x, there's a very large restoring force, which means you're encountering a lot of resistance. This calls for a very stiff spring, a very strong one. It is difficult to either pull it or compress it. On the other hand, if k is very small, then for a certain value of x, you would only get a very small amount of resistance force, which means the spring is soft. So for this reason, there are two names for this constant. One, we call it the spring constant, even though it is not just for spring, it is for any elastic system with a small amount of oscillation, even though we're going to focus mostly on the spring as a very simple example. Another name for it, we call it the stiffness constant, because that's obvious. The larger the value of k, the stiffer the object is, therefore the more difficult it is to compress it or stretch it. So we have this formula, f equals negative kx. That is the force exerted by the spring if I want to stretch it by an amount x or compress it by an amount x. The question now is, suppose I have a mass attached to a spring. I pull the mass by an amount x so that the spring is stretched or compressed by an amount x. All right, now then I let go of my hand. What's going to happen? Well, my hand is no longer exerting a force on the spring, and therefore, the only force exerted on the mass that's attached to the spring is this force itself from the spring. And the question is, under the influence of this kind of force, what kind of motion will the block behave? The block is the mass that's attached to the spring.